The key to success is when you feel lousy, when you feel down, you practice, you try anyway. Why is this so important? Because you always feel down here, right? I never feel great, rarely, right? And everyone is in chronic despair here. So you think, well, if I just felt better, I'd really, really do great. Not necessarily. Sometimes when you feel lousy, you do really well, actually. So this is what we do. And this is, so we're here in support of the momentum, the tremendous momentum now. It's so strong. It's hitting me hard as far as just the stress goes. And everything ancillary stuff that's going on is just almost crazy right now, as the Holy Spirit warned me of. Late June, said late June, starting in late June, then going forward. That's exactly what has happened. Exactly. So we're right on track. Absolutely right on track. Now, what do we do? Is we just put our attention on what is very key, which is that existence is an image. It's just an image, actually. We don't try to make any conclusions at all. This is so important. The wow, you don't make decisions or conclusions at all. So we practice in the wow mode. Always practice in this wow mode. And amazingly, this is the fastest, best way to go. It is not trying to go in with your analytical mind and decide something. This stalls out. This causes stall out. We just stay in the wow. So we say, wow, existence is just an image. Okay, fine. How do we feel about that? Just stay in the wow and just say, wow, okay. Don't generate pro or con. Don't generate pro or con, because familiarity is the key. What we're going for is familiarity with the situation. So as we get familiar with, oh yes, indeed, existence, okay, it really is just an image. And then ultimately, once familiar with all this, then it becomes very easy for us to say, well, I bet maybe playing with an image, isn't that much fun. Well, has it been fun? Maybe even right now, maybe not. And it all becomes sort of almost trivial and easy to see as a no-brainer. So we want to get to the point where it's just a no-brainer, not where we're struggling. So we don't understand that the struggle comes from, or we must understand the struggle comes from familiarity. It doesn't come from stupidity. It doesn't come from failure to be able to analyze. None of that is in play. It's familiarity that's in play. Once we get familiar, just piece of cake, okay? Piece of cake, easy. It's the familiarity that's the difficult part. So when someone's going to going for advice to someone who's aware of all this, call it whatever you want. If you go to a Dharma king, for instance, don't ask questions. Because that puts you in an analytical state of mind. Just wow the whole situation. To be determined, whatever arises, just to stay in this wow of not drawing conclusions one way or the other, not making decisions. You're just staying in the familiarizing yourself with whatever is happening, and just insist that this is key. This is absolutely key. Because the entire situation, once seen as it is, you just have to trust that it's automatically you will make the right decision. It'll be easy. It's an inherency actually to it. So struggling to think, well, I need to make a decision is ridiculous. It's completely inherent once we see what we've really done. We just have to see it and get familiar with it. So this is the right way to proceed upon the path. It's all about familiarity. It's all continuity fear we're dealing with, which is resolved by familiarity, and then the resolution comes of itself automatically we'll just say, oh, of course, I. At some point, we will make the right decision. We're not going to say what it is now. We're not getting a, what is the right decision. We don't want to say that. We don't want to judge. We want to stay away from judgment. We just want to see it as it actually is without judging, well, this is wrong, or oh, how terrible, why I do this. No lamenting. There's no lament. We just stay in this calm, dispassionate, detached, sort of neutral wowness. And this is the key throughout history. This has been discovered over and over again. We're just discovering it again here. This is what leads to liberation, actually, ultimately. But not until we're familiar with how are we tricking ourselves. Oh, we're substituting an image of intrinsic spaciousness for intrinsic spaciousness, and then thinking that that's it, and yet being an image, imagery is vulnerable to other imagery. And so we're just playing with this imagery, thinking that that's really intrinsic spaciousness. And so we just look at this, and say, oh. Don't judge it, just look at it and see it and just say, oh, okay, so that's what we're doing. So you see how patience is so important. Dispassionate patience is so important. Which is what this world is lacking right now. Who's dispassionately patient right now in the world, truly? Where do we go for that? You see? So you have to generate it in yourself right now. There's nowhere to go to get it, really. You have to actually practice it. We do it right here. So it's one of the places, I guess you could say, that we spend time actually in this dispassionate patience of the wow, which is the whole entire key to success, actually. So we're really on the road to success here. Whereas those pursuing spirituality, positivity, are just digging a deeper hole for themselves, actually. Unless they can begin to turn that towards just dispassionate patience. It can be used as a familiarity. Gradually you get familiar with spiritual talk and all that. But if it's primarily to generate some sort of positivity, ultimately you have to see that, be disillusioned from that's just trying to have a positive self-image, a positive self-image. They even say that I'm developing a positive self-image. The I. I stands for image, the positive self-image, the positive self-I, the positive I-self, the positive image self. So don't judge it. Just look at it. Just look at it. Say, oh, okay. This is what we've been doing. So we've been creatively playing with an image, our imagination, the I-self, the imaginary self, the image self. So this dispassionate patience, full stop in the wow, not judging, not deciding, not going, not advancing, not retreating, not embracing, not with withdrawing, just stay exactly as we are, just as we are. We just stay as we are and let everything happen and see what's going on. We just stay just as we are. Not trying to do anything, not trying to do anything at all. Just stay as we are. Not trying to be still, not trying to do, just remain as we are, relaxed in the now, and just whatever arises that gets reaction, we just wow is all we can think or say. The thought just wow. reaction, just wow. Nothing more. Don't allow anything else to enter in. And this minimizes it. It wraps it all up into just one abstract reaction, and it extremely minimizes all your thinking and thoughts and reactions, so you can stay just still and calm and attentive, and you can see the mind, the play of the mind. You will be able to catch glimpses of it, and you become aware of it, and then just say, what? And get familiar with it. Don't judge the mind. Don't judge what's going on. Just get familiar with it. Just seek it. Be familiar with seeing it. And then don't force a result from that. Just keep getting familiar with seeing it. Now, the dearth of those who have succeeded in this points out to the necessity to approach it in the right way. And obviously, you have to conclude that most in the world have not approached it in the right way. The extreme lack of success. Clearly, we can do this because there have been those who have been successful. But in spite of their entreaties and help, we still, most have failed. So they must be, you know, not approaching it in the right way. So don't try to be pro or con anything, even abidance. Don't even be pro abidance or against abidance. Just notice abidance, notice the play of mind in regard to abidance, and just notice it as an observer. Just observe it. Now, I'm just talking about the way to approach it. You may not observe it right away, but as we keep practicing this, you will find that at some point you will be able to. It's like working out. You work out, and at some point you're able to lift something heavy. It's kind of like that. I mean, that's what I started doing. Working out. And I like right now, I'm really weak and tired because I've been working out so much. Wow, just the lower body, the upper body, flexibility, everything. All at the same time, so my body's really tired. I feel like I can hardly lift anything right now. But I know that just give it a little time, let the body bounce back, and at some point I'll grab something that before I couldn't quite do, and it'll be, you know, I'll be able to do it. Piece of cake. Say, ah. In fact, that's happening. I just lift something up. Before I couldn't lift it, I could just lift it up, and it's awkward, but I can handle the awkwardness. I just say, wow. Okay, that's kind of my goal, is to be able to do this stuff that was too difficult and too awkward and too dangerous before, but now I'm able to do it. It's a little thing, but it's a big thing too. I just had something yesterday, I think, was before I just wouldn't have been able to really deal with it properly, and now I was able to. So it's the same thing with our mind. It is, before we struggled, we just couldn't quite deal with it. It's there. You know, I saw the abidance is there. I'm aware of all this, but I couldn't quite deal with it properly. It was too awkward, struggling. So the goal is to get just so you can deal with this properly. That's all. And so we work out, and we feel weak, we feel inept. As you work out, of course you're going to feel that way. You're tired. I'm so tired now. But expect that. Expect it. So don't try to be that superstar. There's so many who go around, you know, there's so many who are seem to be spiritually very positive, spiritually positive, and they seem to be winners, spirit winners in spirituality. And I need to think, wow, here I am, just so, so I'm exhausted right now, so exhausted, and I just feel like so uninspired. But that's the result of very intense practice. Just tremendous effort. I've been giving all this, and so I'm flat, very flat. As I try to see, flatness for what it is. His existence is all flat, actually, totally flat. So be the same way. Realize that your efforts will you'll feel flat, and you feel tired, exhausted, stressed out. It's like hard work. It's really hard work, like hard work in the hot sun, and you feel tired. And others are running around, and you think, wow, if I could only do that, maybe I'd be happy or something. Well, we're not going for happiness, we're going for bliss. And let them run around. Don't worry about it. Don't pay attention. Don't even pay attention. I try not to really pay attention. I just pay attention to, the practice we're doing. Just pay attention to that. Just your own path. Pay attention to your own path. Don't worry about others. And just you were going for that capacity of abidance, the capacity of abidance. We're going for that. That's it. That's all we're going for. We're going for that. And you need a certain kind of strength, a certain type of capacity for that. So we're getting in shape for that. That's what we're working out towards. It's like a physical workout. If you have a certain goal in mind, you structure your workouts so you can meet that goal, right? Whatever that goal may be. If you're going to be a hiker, then you do. If you're going to, people have golfer or some sort of recreation. You do your workouts to get yourself fit for some sort of endeavor, some sort of whatever you're doing. If it's just to look good, you'll diet a lot and try to look slim and do various things to make yourself look good, the body good, or whatever. So you tailor your practice and workouts for your goal. So here we're tailoring our workouts for the goal of abidance. Not many reach this. Not many reach the goal of abidance because they're not aiming for it. Because they want quick gratification. They want the world to view them positively. So they try to present themselves in a very positive light. But this precludes the difficult path where you often feel kind of blah, kind of blahish because it's so difficult. You do a great workout like I did yesterday, you gotta feel sore and tired. And if you work out every day, you get to feel pretty sore and tired every day. And so you're not going to get a lot of positive feedback from the world. You're not. So, positive feedback's overrated. So I'm helpful in this regard. I had great positive feedback my previous life previous to this one. Or my continuum of misery that was back in the 19th century. And I received, enormous acclaim, including, massive state funeral, like the height of acclaim in society. And I can tell you it's not worth it. It amounts to nothing, actually. It really amounts to nothing. So you have all the same mental problems. It's everything, it's just, it doesn't, it's not, it's nothing. It's really nothing. It's not worth it. It's not worth it making your goal trying to get others to like you or give you acclaim. It's not worth it. You'll just find yourself back continuing along with in misery, actually. So this life, I just have foregone all of that and just practice, 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 practice. Not that it's, you still would like the people to like you, like that, but it's really, you realize, that really doesn't work. It doesn't work. So this gives me a great advantage in the situation, I would say, which is, been super helpful, super, super helpful. And probably I see in the world is people are spending too much time trying to impress, trying to be liked, trying to hoping if they get some acclaim, that will really help them feel better about themselves and stuff. And so my great good fortune was I received massive acclaim, and it was a drag. It was just, it doesn't give you what you think at all. And any celebrity will tell you this, really. It's never enough. They need more. No, it's just, it's just, wow, this didn't do it for me. Like, what do I do now? I don't know. More acclaim? That kind of thing. So, but how do you get that? And then you find out that the acclaim that you received was just due to various circumstances that may not be duplicated ever again, actually. I mean, I didn't really deserve the acclaim. And looking back, I didn't really deserve it. I tried to live up to it. It kind of got thrust upon me, actually. And I tried to live up to it, but I felt like I don't really deserve this. I was trying to, so it's very stressful. It's like an entertainer, but for some reason they just know, oh, I really love your music. Become it snowballs, and then the entertainer thinks, wow, I'm not really that talented. I'm getting way too much acclaim. There's others who are way more talented than I am. They're not getting any acclaim at all. So it's a weird thing. It's a weird thing, actually. It's very stressful. But I got the acclaim largely because of my self-confidence and confidence and assurance, and sort of symbolized archetype for people. So somehow they gravitated because I was sort of like an archetypal type of figure, indestructible, very strong, a lot of soul. And depth and intelligence and so healthy and power, everything sort of an archetype. So they it made them feel like that they're sort of part of that archetype. It was like that, but it was just an image. It was an image with depth, you might say. So I was able to present the image of existence in such a way that it made people feel like there's something to it. There's something, maybe there's something to it that's really good, really great. Well, there isn't. I found out there isn't. There isn't anything to it that's good or great. It's misery. It's instability. It's fear. Chronic fear. It's really despair. Chronic despair. We're all in chronic despair, and so if someone comes along that seems to give it some depth and embellish, to the flatness, even though it's an illusion, there is no depth to it. People may cling to that, say, "Oh, you're so wonderful, you're so great," and because it's like you're giving them a little bit of hope for their despair, right? Some hope, and so it's like it's sort of like people are like dying of thirst, and someone comes along and with a nice image of water, and people think, oh, you're so wonderful. I just love that image of water. Oh, it just, if it, I, it, the thought of water is so wonderful. And so they think you're really wonderful. But it's still an image of water. It might be a real nice image of water, but it's not the water itself. And so this is how it goes. So I have this background experience, which is being utilized to our advantage here. I'm using the leverage, so it's very, very helpful. It's unusual, and not many, get that sort of acclaim and live through it and then come back and then and aware of that, as I am aware of the life, and then see, wow, we this that's not that's never going to be the answer. So I'm able to keep practicing here. We're able to keep pushing this forward, where it seems like everyone else has stalled out, really. There's so much stalled out going on in the world, isn't there? It's just astonishing, the stall out that's happening right now. People are hitting a wall, hitting a barrier, and they're stalling out, as expected. They say, well, I don't have enough acclaim. I don't have enough, I need more friends. I need more friends. Facebook is kind of weird, actually. It's really not kind of. It is. Man, it's just, people are stalled out. We're stalled out. That's okay. Just notice it. Dispassionately, just notice it. Okay, there's a big, massive stall out taking place. We feel we don't have enough self-esteem. Our self-image isn't strong enough. Our self-image isn't strong enough. We need to enhance our self-image. This is the New World Order. Let's all enhance our self-image. That's the problem, they say. But we're seeing it just, oh, we're just making an image of reality in order to then play with that image and make it seem that reality is vulnerable. See, our purpose with making this image is to try to convince reality that it's vulnerable. But we only end up sort of convincing ourselves. It's like an attack. It's attack on reality, attempt to attack reality. That's what Jesus tells us, and it certainly looks that way. And so, images, of course, can be changed to make it seem like they're being attacked. But it's just the image that's being attacked. It's not reality that's being attacked. Okay, now, let's shift gears a little bit here. We have a car that we can shift gears in, right? Absolutely. It's not automatic transmission that we've got no control over it. We can shift gears whenever we want to. So we have this very, very intense situation where there's a massive stall out taking place. Very interesting. One of our dear friends is in the hospital, very unstable, ventilator, feeding tube, morphine, all this stuff, internal hemorrhage in the brain, up and down, very dicey situation, actually. And his son came to see him, and his son, upon seeing him, passed out unconscious. It was such a shock to him, because he doesn't look like himself at all anymore. It really couldn't take it. It just shocked him so bad, he came unconscious. So, this is a metaphor for the world, is that the world is stalling out so bad now. Stalling out into self-image. You know, we got to develop positive self-image. You know, how do we do that? Well, spirituality, positive spirituality. Positive this. We need a positive self-image. We're stalling out so bad that if you look upon it, it's almost like you lose, you become unconscious. You're such a shock. Maybe this is part of the strain I'm feeling, is I'm just looking at Facebook and everything that's going on. I'm just saying, wow, everybody's stalled out. Almost everyone. There's a few that are still working on it, but it's almost like it's vanishing. Our dear friend, his kidneys are not working, you know, so he's getting all bloated. Stuff stops working. And so, it's like everyone's suddenly stalling out on the path. They are now clinging to a self-image, trying to find a positive self-image. Of course, that's what we've always done. So it's just the same old, really. And this stall out is so shocking that it's causing me trouble. It's causing all of us. I believe there are those here watching this video that are very aware of what I'm saying, and it's causing them trouble too. They're feeling like, wow, I sort of feel like, you know, like am I stalling out? Should I stall out along with everybody else? And it's like that. So what do we do? I'm calling upon the Tibetan masters, the Dharma kings, in particular. I'm working for Longchenpa, and he's sent his associate, Jamyang Kyentse Choki Lodro, to sort of be my friend. He friended me. So I friended him back. And so, you know, I'm trying to bond it in that friendship, develop that friendship with him. And he has, you know, just extraordinary capabilities. Vast. So it's a great friend to have. And so I'm trying to call upon him. I'm trying to focus in on him. And the ego doesn't like it, of course. Ego's very mocking of all this. So it's difficult to talk about because, you know, there's still some continuity fear around it all. But he's showing up. He's giving evidence to me, very powerful evidence, that he is absolutely aware of the situation. He's aware of me. He's aware of my situation. He's got my back, powerfully got my back. There's tremendous power behind his capacity. Backing him up is Longchenpa, is Padmasambhava, is all the Bodhisattvas in Tibetan Buddhism, along with the other Dharma kings. So in other words, he has an enormous backing to carry out his purpose, which is to as an action guru, to help all of us, actually, through tremendous skillful means, subtle skillful means, whatever skillful means is necessary. I feel this is what he will do. We don't know. Now, maybe in your case, you have someone else that's sent to you. But ask the Dharma kings to send you, you know, tell them that you've accepted their offer of taking refuge in their court, and then they'll match you up with someone that you feel compatible with. Of course, they will match for compatibility. That's what Longchenpa did. He matched me for compatibility with one of his, you know, top associates. And so this is what we do right now. As everyone's stalling out, how do you avoid this stall out yourself? Call upon the Dharma kings. That's what I've been emphasizing for quite some time now. And decide, yeah, I'm going to, you know, go in this court or all of them, whatever you like, and ask, you know, just in your mind, just decide, it's a done deal, I've done it, I've committed, commit. I've said this in many videos previously leading up to this time, commit to a court of a Dharma king. You will be matched up with someone's compatible, and that someone will be someone of immense capability in every which way, every 360 degree. They're enlightened. Someone who's absolutely enlightened, a dedicated saint, servant of God, really. And they will, they'll have your back in a powerful way. They'll have your back in a powerful way. And so all day long, I'm just sort of praying to him and you know, asking him to have my back, and getting used to the fact that he's got my back, and nothing, you know, no trouble can come to me. Instead of worrying, I just turn to him and in super positive reassurance, just thank him for having my back. Instead of begging, I don't beg, I say, I know you got my back, so thank you very much. I very much appreciate it. It's like that. So shift from petitioning and begging and hoping. Don't hope. Assert that I know you have my back, and so I'm rejoicing in that fact. I can't lose. We're going to be, you know, super team, part of a super team. So team up at this point with the Dharma kings and their associates, and then they will protect you. They will protect you. They'll protect your spiritual momentum. They'll make sure that nothing, because you're important to them, because you're extending, you know, the truth and the momentum of God's grace in the world. their whole role is to make sure that that increases. So they're going to make sure that you're part of that increasing of spiritual momentum, God's grace, the Dharma, the gospel. They're going to make sure that you are successful at that. This is their whole purpose. Their entire focus is on this. They're not just saying, well, if you do help out, that's fine. If you don't, that's fine. We don't really care one way or the other. No, it's not that nonchalant. They absolutely do care. The whole Bodhisattva vow is about absolute caring about all beings until every one of us is liberated from the self-image, where we set it down and say, oh, that doesn't interest me in it anymore. So that's it. We just gently set it down and say, okay, I see what I did. This house is kind of silly, wasn't it? Yeah. So, but they're dedicated to it. So they're dedicated. These Dharma kings are dedicated. So don't hesitate. When I boost Jamyang Kenshi Choki Lodro and talk about him, boost him, and look at his picture, and I can't really. I say, what does he look like? And he sort of has a strange look. I say, what's he doing? Well, he's crying. I can see he's crying because he's so happy that someone is boosting him and talking about him in this positive light. Is not afraid to speak up, and someone's accepting his help. I mean, imagine you have all these capacities and nobody turns to you for help. Probably it's the story of our lives, isn't it? Well, that's the story of his life. How many people are turning to him for help right now? There are many people like him, on Facebook. You put it, the likes, okay, I like that, everybody sees it, like. But how many are actually turning to him with tremendous faith and accepting him as a teammate here, and allowing him to help them out literally in every aspect of their life? How many are actually doing that is the question. Well, that's what he's here for. That's what these Dharma kings are here for. Here to help us out. And we just keep trying to do it ourselves. This is so amazing, isn't it? Just notice it. Just say, wow. It's so wowish. Like, wow. It's astonishing. So, Longchenpa too, I swear, I'm aware. What is it they're feeling? I say, oh my gosh, they're just weeping. They're so happy they're weeping that someone is turning to them with faith and asking them to help out and really counting on them and believing, having faith in them, truly having faith that they can help out. Some say that faith is just a myth of religion. You know what's a myth is the present civilization is a myth. Humanism is based, the entire thing, secular humanism is based on just myth, absolute myth. The whole structure is nothing but myth. The myth of not believing in God, not believing in the Dharma kings, not believing in God's grace, all that, that's completely mythical. Not believing in reality, totally mythical. So they're the ones that are completely caught up in myth, 100% caught up in myth. And we're the ones who are not caught up in myth and superstition and at all. We're the ones who are actually paying attention to reality. They're not paying attention to reality at all. They're saying it doesn't exist. That's a myth, okay? But nobody's turning to these teachers. They say, "Well, that they're mythical." No. It's not turning to them that's mythical. They're real, and saying they're not is just a myth, completely mythical. This mythical realm where there's no bodhisattvas, where there's no enlightened ones, where there's no God, where there's no God grace. We live in this mythical realm. No, we don't. Nobody lives in such a realm. Nobody's ever lived in such a realm. It's completely mythical, and that they're pretending as if it's real. It's just astonishing. But we're familiar with it. We just look at it and say, "Wow." So it's really extricating yourself from a mythical realm that doesn't really exist at all. The realm where, you know, there's no spiritual truth. We're coming out of a dream. That's a dream. That's a dream. That's a fantasy. That's a make-believe realm, mythical realm. There's no reality to it. Oh, it doesn't exist at all. The reality always exists. These help is always present for us. It's always been that way. So we're just getting real here. It's the others that are going into a mythical dream that they say, hey, well, it'll be a lot of fun, boys. Yeah, well, when has it ever been fun? It's never been fun, actually. It's never been fun. No, but everybody's here in chronic, it's in chronic despair. So we're not turning to them. We're not turning to them. The world has turned their backs on them. Imagine if you have a capability to enlighten us, and everyone, nobody turns towards you. It's just story of my life, story of your life, right? It's horrible. I'm able to give this advice, and you know, it's just like extremely difficult to come across those who want to hear the advice. And thankful, very thankful for those who do. Really, it's tremendous. It could be even fewer, and it may be fewer coming up. So, screensaver keeps kicking on. That's okay. Blacks out. Move it. Comes back. We went into a mythical state, and now we just pulled right out. Came right out of that mythical state. Okay. This dark, deep, dark despair the world's going into is just a mythical, make-believe, fairy tale nonsense. That's all it is. All atheistic things, fairy tale nonsense. Yet they think the others is. That's just how, you know, absurd they're being. Totally absurd. They insist a priori there is no proof, and then they demand that you prove it to them. I mean, is that not absurd? Of course it is. They've already decided there's no such thing as proof of God. And then they claim that, well, it's up to you to prove it to them. Well, you can't prove anything to them, someone who's going off-premise that they're not going to examine any evidence. They just decided a priori, this is their basic premise, that God doesn't exist. Therefore, ergo prom sumpter, therefore, there can't be proof. So they've already decided there can't be proof in order to be logical with their premise. Well, you know, the premise is false. You know, first, prove that this premise is true before we accept it. And they're just going on blind faith entirely. Blind faith. Okay, now we... There's informed faith and there's blind faith. They're going on blind faith. We're going on informed faith. The Dharma kings give us plenty of so much subtle and various ways of letting us know that they're present. They're aware of the whole situation. They're aware of us, and so we're not aware of them constantly. So we have to have some faith to keep our momentum going. That's positive faith, positively informed faith, super positive faith. Of course, that's the right thing to do. But the people, they lack faith. They don't turn to these Dharma kings for help right now. They have no faith at all in them. They have blind faith in a fairy tale realm, mythical realm. Doesn't exist except in their own conclusions, illogical conclusions. This realm really doesn't exist at all. It's just our illogical conclusions tell us that it should exist, but there's no evidence that it does at all actually. We just keep thinking, well, it should exist. And so all we're doing is we're looking at this, our thoughts saying that it should exist, but it doesn't at all. There's no such realm as we are concluding exists, that you know, there's no God, no grace of God, and no presence of bliss and reality and all that. No such realm exists at all, actually. Just we conclude through illogic, through a false premise, that it should exist, but it doesn't. And so they just stubbornly say, yeah, but it should. Little you know, train should, chugging away into despair, into the tunnel of despair. I mean, logic tells us it should if the premise is right, but the premise is wrong. So that's what's important. So again, they're being underutilized, the Dharma King, severely. Shockingly. I'm so shocked by it. The like Nyingma masters on Facebook, well, they put up a picture of Longchenpa or Jamyang or someone else like that, and one of the Rinpoches and this, and Jumi Pham, various, you know, Nyingma masters, and you know, they get 1,000 likes but 0 comments. I'm not like the only one commenting. It's like, what? Liking? I don't like them. I'm paying homage at their feet and turning to them and turning my life, giving my life to them, and says, it's in your hands. That's not just liking. I mean, good grief. Express your homage to them and let them hear it. Let them know it. You've got to put it out there. You've got to commit. Liking is that the commit? You like people on Facebook. There's different people on Facebook. There's those that everything they see they like. Boom, 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 boom. Yeah, that's good. I appreciate that. Really, it's better than not liking. And there's others that just don't like anything. They just look, but they don't like it. But most people don't comment at all on anything. I've noticed this. There's just a few that comment, but usually a comment is just like a couple words. That's it. Very, very few actually put a sentence together. Very few. And almost even fewer put like a couple sentences together in commentary. So if you comment on Facebook, at least the spiritual sites and stuff, you might be the only one commenting. It's very odd. People are not connecting. You know, like, but can you not? Someone says, this, you know, Paramahansa is so wonderful. Then you can comment on what they said. You know, thank you so much for your comment. They see this, and they can comment back to you. And you actually have a connection with somebody. Are people really connecting on Facebook? It doesn't feel like it at all to me. They're still all isolated. Everyone is still completely isolated. How does this connect you? We just like a picture or something. You click the like button. We think that we're all friends now. We're all connecting. What in the world? It's just bizarre. Just like now people are just texting. Well, how much connection do you get to the person through texting? Hello? You know. Have a conversation with somebody. Go back and forth. A little bit. You know, start building a rapport and a trust with someone. So you need to do that with the Dharma Kings. Build a rapport. Go back and forth. Trust back and forth. Give of yourself to them. You'll get back. And give more. Get back. You start building a rapport. How else could you trust them when times get bad and everyone stalls out? If you don't have this rapport built up. Rapport doesn't come about through, you know, texting, thanks, like, smiley face. Is it you building up rapport? Come on. And people are despairing on Facebook. They say, look, I don't know. Are you really my friends? Right? Like me if you're really my friend. A couple of likes. Oh, I do have friends. Somebody liked. Hit the like button. I don't know. Do you really make friends on Facebook? It doesn't seem so, does it? It's bizarre. Where do you make friends now? You don't make them on YouTube anymore. People have stopped commenting. It used to be that there was a lot of commenting back and forth and stuff. It's almost disappeared. And on Facebook, I think it used to be more commenting. Now it's just liking, and that's about it. And it's like, or a little emoticon or something. Is this progress or is this regression? Are we really more connected or are we less connected? I'd say we're less connected. When you go out in the world, you know, people are just all in this texting emoticon mode. They don't want to talk with you. You can't just see someone, hey, how's it going? You know, and have it. It's difficult. It's very difficult. Now it's getting more and more and more difficult just to have this feeling like you can walk up to people and just start talking with them. Why not? I mean, that's connecting with people. But people don't, they're only on their smartphones hitting a like button or whatever. So is that connecting with people? No, that's the opposite, actually. It's weaning us away from genuine connection. This is what technology does. It isolates us, turns us into robots. It's a disastrous sort of thing, actually. And if you see it in hindsight, looking back, it used to be, we thought, well, wow, this is great. We're really going to connect with everybody. And I've lived through it all, as many as you have. And I've been checking it out the whole way along. And it's gone downhill, 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 downhill. Used to be like groups on Yahoo and stuff were thriving. And you look at that now, and you check the posts, and year by year by year by year, they have, you know, it goes yearly. And virtually all of them are just disintegrated into nothing. And I'm so stunned by it. I said, this is a great idea, great group, but people just drop out. And there's something about trying to connect by over digitally, you know, that just doesn't satisfy people. So they're reduced now to just, it's pretty much like Facebook now, actually. And that seems to be disintegrating also. I don't know what people are going to do coming up. I think they're going to despair, because they're not really connecting the way they want to. They're not being fulfilled at all, at all. And now it pretty much just emoticon, you know, shrug of the shoulders, bleh, you know, just these kind of reactive sort of buttons, and that's about it. You know, you talk about isolation, isolating us, one another. Technology's done a great job isolating. They say they've done a great job connecting. They've actually done a great job isolating us. It's the opposite of what they've said, which is not surprising, because they were slimy from the very beginning, all these tech people, actually. Their ideology was obviously very deceitful from the get-go. They're spiritual materialists, claiming, oh, we're going to connect the world, all this kind of stuff. But what they've done is they've isolated everybody from one another, actually. I mean, can you just, like in high school, or you could just walk up, someone's sitting outside lunchtime in the high school, you just walk up and just sit down next to them. Just say, hey, how's it going? Man, going okay. I don't know. And then just start talking with them. And you just share, you know, start sharing their perspectives and stuff and back and forth and their philosophy and things. And you just hang out. You just be able to just do that. And you know, young people are but nowadays, is it really like that? No, everybody's just, you know, into their liking, like it's a like button stuff. And just doing a couple lines of text back and forth. Oh, really? Oh, my God. You know, OMG. Oh, yeah, okay, blah, blah, blah. It's just a sort of texting level. Are you really just actually connecting with them, with their body language, with how they really feel, the intensity and the presence? Are you connecting with their presence? Is that really happening? I know they say that we're all just mental, you know, and there's no body, has nothing to do with it. But the body actually is reflecting the mind. It's like a mirror. So the person there is you could see, you know, what they're really feeling, how they're really reacting. And you know, there's a presence to them that the smartphone is really getting the presence of a smartphone. That's what you're really getting. So it's a disaster. This whole tech, as I said from the very beginning, and many wise ones, Krishnamurti said, this is going to be a disaster. A disaster is coming upon the world, he said. These spiritual materialists are coming into the world with their advanced technology and organizational systems, as he saw what was coming. And he said, it's going to be a disaster. It's going to pull everyone down into a delusion. This is a very bad stall out is going to happen. And he has turned out to be very prophetic. So how do we keep ourselves from stalling out? This is what's important. How do we keep ourselves from stalling out? We turn to the Dharma kings. I just used this phrase. It just sort of occurred to me. Why not just call the Dharma kings? Why not use that? The Dharma kings. Dharma means the momentum of spiritual grace in the world. Those who promote and extend spiritual grace. Dharma, you might call it spiritual grace, actually. But there's a practical element. It's the practical side of spiritual grace. It's the practical side of it. Of course, all grace ultimately is practical. But it's the practicing. It's the actual, you know, getting down to it. Not just positivity, but actually practicing. The Dharma has a connotation of real commitment. I mean, commitment to the spiritual, to truth, to commitment to spiritual truth. Dharma might be commitment to spiritual truth, and everything that's involved with commitment to spiritual truth is what we would say Dharma, D-H-A-R-M-A. So the Dharma kings are the ones who are most effective in helping us in our commitment to spiritual truth. Those are the ones that are super, super helpful. And have great, great experience in this. So when we don't want to stall out in our commitment, we turn to the Dharma kings to help us with our commitment to spiritual truth. We say, we need help right now. We're really in trouble here. Massive stallouts coming. A tsunami, a stallout tsunami is coming. Of despair. A stallout tsunami of despair is coming in this world. And it's likely to, you know, to grab us. Say, oh, in order to be happy, I got to be stalled out too, because if I'm isolated from everyone, I'll be unhappy. Well, there's some pull to that, isn't there? If you're ostracized, you do feel lousy despair, like, oh, I can't get along with everybody, I can't communicate, I can't relate, because they're all isolated and you're not, and they only relate to isolation. Oh, they say, are you isolated? Yeah. Oh, great. Text you. Oh my God, I'm isolated too. Oh great. Oh wow. Okay. Well, you know, good. You know, whatever. Lol, I'm isolated. You're isolated? Yeah, I'm isolated. Okay, great. We're all getting good isolated now. Following the ego's premise that if we're all miserable, then misery, then there's no such thing as misery. If we're all insane, there's no such thing as insanity. This is the ego's premise. Its primary premise is if we're all insane, then there's no such thing as insanity. Therefore, everything's fine. We'll call it good. You know, and no problem. This is the ego. That's the ego's basic premise, and it never deviates from that premise at all. All its logic, all its advice is like a spider web leading us, entangling us in down into this, with this, the center of the web, where the spider of absolute misery is there, and claiming that if we're all miserable, there's no misery. It's kind of like saying if reality didn't exist, we wouldn't have a problem with being separate from it. Yeah, right. Well, if it didn't exist, how could we even think about being separate from it? It's crazy. If reality didn't exist at all, then there's no separation problem, right? Well, yeah, right. But there's nobody to be happy about that either, is there? There's just nothing at all. There wouldn't be anybody to see that there's nothing at all either. So the ego is just completely, the premise of the ego is completely insane. And yet this is what the world is following. And so all the ego's advice actually pulls you down. It may seem initially that it bends a little this way and that way, and you think, oh, okay, I'm getting over on the ego here. But no, it always knows how to compound and leverage you down, 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 down into misery. The spider web of misery. Entangle, entangle, more and more entanglement, more and more severe entanglement, until you feel so entangled, you just think you never get escape. And the ego says, well, that's good. You know, when you finally accept you can't escape from misery, guess what? No more misery. This is what it tells you. But what you really get is mental chaos. And the ego says, you found it. You finally found what you're looking for. I said, actually, that's not what I was looking for. And the ego says, what? How dare you contradict what I have to say? I say, well, I got no choice. I cannot hang out in mental chaos. It's just not my, it's not my hangout place. I'm not created that way. The ego says, what do you mean? You're not created that way. I created you that way. Well, guess what? Guess what, ego? I guess you didn't create me because I can't hang out in it. You said you created me. This is my home, mental chaos. So, you said, so the very fact I couldn't abide in it proves you didn't create me. You're not the creator. Because I could feel, totally feel, that I wasn't created for mental chaos. I cannot hang on. It's not my home. So right there, prove the ego's a liar. It didn't create us. And then that's when it gets very upset. It has a hissy fit. You know, really. It's like, wow. You know, are you mad, bro? You know, really? Yeah, the ego's mad. And when you find out it didn't create you, it gets really mad. Well, you know, just gotta let the ego be mad for a while. Really, there's nothing else you can do. And just head on back to God, really. I mean, head on back to accepting what did create you, right? And what you were created for. There's no other way to go. The ego says, well, we're co-creators, you know. I created you and the God created you. No. That's mental chaos. Oscillating between truth and lies. What is that? That's mental chaos. So the ego had no role in creating us at all. None. We didn't have any role in creating ourselves. We have a role in extending the creation, but we had no role at all in creating ourselves, the reality. Except that we are one with God. We're the expression of God, so to speak. But God, there has to be, you know, God is the primary, is primary. Primary is primary. It's not secondary, and it's not co-primary. It's just primary. So we just get familiar with this in a non-analytical way. Keep a sense of humor. Stay in the wow of not judging it. That's why we kind of laugh, and we're staying away from judging it. We're just looking at it. As Krishnamurti said, let's just look at this together. He was very skillful, Krishnamurti. Probably very underrated. He would say, let's just all look at this together. Don't try and judge it. Let's just see what's there to see. This is the right way to do it. He's very skillful, Krishnamurti. He was a big part of my life early on, because he was very popular and well known in California, especially and in the West. He lived in Ojai, California, for a long time. Gave big talks there. That was many people went to those talks. Academics and bigwigs and intellectuals and all this kind of stuff. From Southern California, but some from Northern too. I mean, he draw very the intelligentsia went to see him. And he was tremendous. And we had his books. Oh, we had all his books in the house, and I read all his books. I was very knowledgeable about Krishnamurti at a young age, very young age. Because I started out from day one listening to my parents, especially my dad, talk about spiritual stuff. Always was talking about spiritual teachers, and I would dialogue and talk to them about it. And then as soon as I could read, I started reading spiritual books. That's it. Pretty much so. You know, most books I read, I tried to read I'd pick up Krishnamurti book and read it when I don't know, 6, 7, 8, whenever I was capable, I'd struggle with it and try to figure out and what's this word mean, I just started reading right off the bat spiritual books. And so I'm very aware of Krishnamurti, and he's let us just look at this together basically say, let's just stay in the wow of this. Let's just wow what we're doing here in general. Just wow it. So there's a snag coming in this world. There's a snag. There's a stall out. There's a snag coming. It's going to come from the left, as you might expect. Something is going to happen, and we're going to say, we're not going to feel right anymore. You know, we're just not going to feel right. Something's going to hit a snag. I don't know if the election's going to hit a snag, right? Something like that, where we don't feel America's America anymore. We feel uncomfortable with it. It gives us the creeps. It just says there's something really creepy going on here. Really creepy. This is going to happen. And so at that point, we feel, wow, we can't rely upon the world, our self-image anymore, can we? So much of what we are is self-image, right? What we think we are. We've built our house upon sand, the sand of self-image. There's no doubt. I mean, I have, you have, we all have, basically, right? I mean, built on the sand of self-image, and we have to get on the rock of intrinsic spaciousness, the rock of reality. So we better ask for help now in doing so, because we can't fail. Otherwise, we'll accept the myth of the secular humanist myth. It's a myth, secular humanist myth is all it is. And that's a terrible place to be. It's just, it's nothing but despair. Nothing but despair, really. Initially, it seems like, yeah, we're getting everybody to join us. Oh, great, 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 great. Because join. It's like a pyramid scheme. Join. Initially, pyramid schemes seem great. But then when people start realizing, oh my gosh, this is a pyramid scheme. I got snagged. Then that's when the despair sets in. And then when it sets in real hard. And the pyramid schemes, of course, it's the ones that start it that did benefit, and the ones that get snagged in are just like drones working for them. They have to spend all their money to, you know, buy into it, getting the merchandise, all this. They spend, and they realize the only way they can get any money is convince others to jump into the pyramid scheme also. But those below them, they know that they're just. You'll spend to help me, but I'm spending to help the ones above me, and they're spend to help the ones above them, blah, 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 blah. And none of us are going to make it. Only the ones at the very top are going to get filthy rich from it. And then at that point, you feel despair, don't you? It's all a pyramid scheme. And you've invested heavily in that pyramid scheme. Well, existence is even worse than a pyramid scheme. There's nobody benefiting ultimately at all. And you realize there's nobody in this myth, humanist myth, that knows anything. None of them know what they're talking about. There's no wisdom at all in secular humanism. None. Zero. This is scary. I've already experienced this. I said, whoa, wait a minute. My education's leading me into this, secular humanism. These people don't know what they're talking about. They literally are morons. As far as their understanding goes, I said, wow, you got to get out of this. This is hideous. They got to turn around, go back towards the Dharma Kings who know what they're talking about. But the last place you want to be is a place where everyone's blind, right? I mean, how happy are you if you're blind and everyone else is blind? Did you say, oh, whoopee, let's call it good. If we're all blind, great. Now everything's fine. How long does that last, that idea? It might for a minute, an instant. Like you think, well, everyone's blind. Oh, okay, then nobody's better than me, and we're all the same. Wonderful. And then you say, wait a minute, though. Something's wrong with this. So just imagine that. We're a land where everyone's blind, and everyone's been blinded. And then for a minute, the ego says, all right, we finally succeeded. And everyone says, oh, for an instant, they think, we made it. And then right away this nagging feeling starts arising, like, what's that? Something doesn't feel quite right. I'll say, well, I'm still blind, so how do I get around? And there's nobody with eyes to help me get around at all. And then you start to say, uh-oh, this is really bad. I better find someone that's at least got one eye, right? In the land of the blind, the one eye person is king. Is the boss? Is awesome? Is wowish? The one eyed person is wowish, you might say, to those who are blind. In the land of the blind, the one-eyed person is Wawish. So they said, oh my gosh, this didn't work the way we thought it would work. How come we didn't think of that on the... Well, because we were so, you know, we were so, what? the ego really, you know, we played ourselves for a fool, basically. At that point, you wonder, how could I possibly have been so stupid? And it's astonishing. You weren't stupid. You were... The ego is very clever. So basically, it's extreme cleverness and trickiness that led us to such a stupid conclusion. And you'd like to be able to say, oh, okay, it's just, how could I, but the feeling is, how could I have been so stupid? And you get stuck there. You get stuck there because you can't figure it out. So we don't try to figure out every move the ego made and how, we don't try to figure it out. The answer is don't try to figure it out. Because what good is that? We think that's the answer. No, that's not the answer. The answer is to begin to open your eyes. You know, it's kind of like everyone's blind, and I go, how could I have been so stupid to believe that if everyone's blind, I'll be happy? And then you start trying to figure out, well, how was I so stupid? I can't believe I'm so stupid. Now, what exactly caused me to think this way? And yet your eyes are still closed. And so you spend, you know, all your whole life just thinking, what did the ego do? How could I? And your eyes are still closed. Why don't you just work on opening your eyes? Isn't this the? So if we don't open our eyes, we're still being stupid. So we spend all our time trying to figure out what the ego, and we're still being just stupid because we could just open our eyes. So if we're trying to get over the fact that we've been so stupid, how do we get over that fact by continuing to be just as stupid? It just compounds it, doesn't it? And we really get despair. We feel despair. Wait, I spent all this effort trying to figure out why I was so stupid, yet I still feel I'm being very stupid. And then you realize, oh my gosh, that's because I haven't been opening my eyes. Why don't I just open my eyes? Oh, I didn't know I could open my eyes. So, open my eyes? What? What are you talking about? I'm blind. No. The ego just convinced you to close your eyes, thinking that that's the answer. You're not blind, you just closed your eyes. You can open them again. Huh? But if I admit to that, then I'm really stupid. You know, I thought that I was losing my eyesight, but just you saying I just closed my eyes. Wow, that's really stupid. But what we really were doing was trying to see if we could get away with being really stupid. We're saying, is there a way to get away with being really stupid? Because telling God that, well, guess what, God, reality's changed now, is being really stupid. So we're trying to figure out, is there a way we can do that and not really know that we're doing it? Like, so, yeah. And if we don't really know that we're doing it, then we say, well, it must be done then. We didn't do it. We don't know how we did it. You know, it's just done. It happened. Oh, my eyes. That blindness just happened. You know, it happened. So it is completely stupid. And yet we're trying to see, can we get away with complete stupidity? Can we get away with it? Whatever that means, right? So, yeah. So it's got this double dynamic to it. It is very simple, and yet we're trying to get away from seeing that it's very simple, that we can't change reality. That's all we've been trying to do. We try to disguise what we're doing, so we think God doesn't know what we're doing. What we're really doing is we're changing reality, but we're trying to make it so complex and complicated that God's saying, it's like we think God has to defend against it. Like, as if... If God can't figure out how we're changing reality, then he can't stop it from happening. So we can't figure out, how did we get blind, you know? Like, how did we change? God's perplexed, like, oh, wow, they're so clever. God's not paying any attention to our cleverness at all. We can't change reality. So one insight settles it all. One insight settles it all. Just listen to this here. There's one insight settles it all. This is a great practice to just hold this assertion. One insight settles it all. And believe it. Believe that. One insight settles it all. Really believe it because it's true. So start believing in this. Okay, one insight settles it all. One insight settles it all. So now, this is a powerful, powerful tool that we've been given by Longchenpa. Padmasambhava Longchenpa, Jamin Kenshi Chogyi Lodro, the Holy Spirit. One insight settles it all. So when you're struggling with this, trying to pay homage to your cleverness and complexity, thinking that somehow this empowers you, just tell yourself to disengage with your struggle. To disengage with your struggle, just say, one insight settles it all. One insight settles it all. And believe in that, because it's true. It's true. I believe in this. I've seen what the insight ultimately is, that there is an insight. And we have to accept that just one insight settles it all. That's the end of it all. Settles it all. One insight settles it all. It's there. It's just that because what I just explained here, we're believing that struggling with complexity and all, we're believing it, we the way we're looking at it, it blinds us to this insight. But if we look at it in a different way, we see it exactly all it's needed is just this one insight, and it settles the whole situation, settles everything for us. So I absolutely believe in this. So one insight will settle everything. But it's difficult to get to it, but we can. We are getting to it. We've already gotten to it. Say that. I've already gotten to it. And it's all, one insight did settle it all. You could even practice this way. One insight did settle it all. Okay. I can feel, by practicing that way, produced a tremendous wow reaction. Triggered it. One insight did settle it all. State that with as if this has actually happened. You know this has already happened. One insight did settle it all. And here comes the wow from that. Now I'm getting kind of tired of the wow. Yeah. Because it is stressful. But, you know, it's a workout. Great day here in California. One insight did settle it all. Wow. One insight did settle it all. Meaning you're speaking now from experience, hindsight. So, as much as possible, speak from hindsight. As if you already have this hindsight. One insight did settle it all. So speaking as if you have hindsight about all this, this is a powerful, extraordinary way to practice. One insight did settle it all. Wow. So this is just reverberating through my psyche as the wow does, you know, just bouncing off the walls. It's like, wow. This is Narasada, Sagarada Maharaj says. He says, really, it comes all at once. And it's like you pivot into another dimension from which you see everything in the right way. And then you say, ah, yeah, that's how it all is, actually. It is all settled just like that. So one insight did settle it all. So we practice as if we've already had the insight, and indeed, it did settle it all, that we know this now through experience. So we practice knowing from experience. The best practice is to practice asserting that we already know from experience what is true. So there's no need to think about it, is there? See how it cuts out thinking and thoughts? This is indeed true. I already know this is true. Indeed, this turned out to have been true. Indeed, this is what I experienced. That one insight did indeed settle it all. One insight did indeed settle it all. So we're practicing from the standpoint that we've already had the experience. So again, when you've already had an experience, all the speculation and questions, blah, 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 gone. You've already had the experience. So now you know. You already know. It's the end of it as far as speculation. There's no more speculation. One insight did indeed settle it all. All right? That's it. End of the questions of does it or does it not. Finished. It's kind of like the World Series or something, or the World Cup. Who's going to win? Who's going to win? Endless speculation. Who's going to win? Well, when it's over, you know who won. So do you keep speculating who's going to win? Who does that? Nobody does. Nobody does that. If they do, people say they're insane. You don't say, well, I don't know who's going to, Germany or Brazil, I'm not really sure, it's really, both teams are strong, but blah, 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 blah. Say, what are you talking about, dude? I mean, the World Cup's over and, you know, such and such country won. So at this point, you don't speculate who's going to win. That people would say you're insane, right? So when we practice that it's already occurred, experience already happened, one insight did indeed settle it all. That just knocks out all speculation and thinking, doesn't it? And so we get used to not thinking, not speculating by practicing this way. We get familiar with it, which is what's important in abidance. In abidance, we realize there's no speculation or thinking taking place anymore. And this is what kind of freaks us out. I say, what's this? It's weird. I'm not used to this. So what we're doing, we're getting used to no thinking and no speculation ahead of time. And once we're used to that, then it's easy to just easily shift, power shift into abidance. So we do that by simulating the situation. One insight did indeed knock it all out, settle everything. One insight did indeed settle everything. And just wow, that's it. So it's super important to get used to abiding with no concepts, no thinking, no planning, no scheming, no speculation, you might call it. No speculation at all. This is what eases us into abidance. You can't think your way into abidance. You can't speculate your way into it at all. Because when you reach abidance, there's no speculation there, thinking, and it's gone. And then you say, whoa, 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 I'm not used to that. Whoa, continuity crisis, continuity crisis. As I said, continuity fear is the only problem we have, meaning all thinking, all speculation, gone forever. And we think, and we're so used to speculating, we say, get me out of here. Get me out of here. How do I get out of here? Well, just imagine the image of it and then change the image. There you go. And you shifted your attention to an image. But when we're used to no speculating, then we don't need to shift our attention back to any image. We just say, okay. Because images then just breed speculation. Well, we don't really know, how to get free of this image. How do we get free? How are we going to win? Will it really settle everything? I'm not sure. Let me think about this. One insight settles it all. One insight did indeed settle it all. One insight did indeed settle it all. So I'm very glad I made this video and made the effort, because I'm feeling really, really low, low energy. The way I've been exercising, I can't. I've got to realize that it's because of this. Just maybe overdoing it a little bit, or I don't know. I was actually going to start working out my legs today, and I got a call that prevented me from continuing on. But I was going to do a massive workout today, and probably would have caused severe hamstring cramps and everything. So I'm glad that I got called away. I don't know why I felt I should have done that. But I'm kind of in a desperation mode of let's just push it. So I'm really pushing everything here. But this, it's bearing fruit, because now we're seeing, wow, this way of practicing is the way. One insight did indeed knock it all out, settle it all. One insight did indeed. So you're taking the standpoint of hindsight that you know who won the World Cup. In other words, this team did indeed win the World Cup. And then any thought, anything arise around that speculation? No, nothing. Now in the world, then we jump right into the next, well, who's going to win the next World Cup? Right? If the World Series is over, and right away you say, okay, who's going to win the next World Series? Always, that's what I always did. It never stopped. Speculating never stopped. Who's going to win the next game? Who's going to win the next game? Who's going to win the next game? Speculation. Keeping speculation alive. I did that just to appear normal in this world. Otherwise, I would lapse into, it's all settled. One insight, I'd see the insight, it would settle it all, and then be enlightened. And so to avoid enlightenment, I had to speculate all the time. But I've stopped doing that. I'm not speculating anymore on sporting events and thinking who's going to win, trying to judge and evaluate and everything. I don't even know. I don't care. I'm not speculating on political outcomes or social outcomes or anything. Just not speculating at all. Just practicing. One insight did indeed settle it all. One insight did indeed settle it all. Wow, what a fabulous practice. Second to none. Second to none, this practice. And this is all thanks to the grace of God and how it pragmatically plays out for us through the Dharma Kings and their associates. One insight did indeed settle it all. Now, I've been praying all day to Jamyang Kensi Jogi Lodra. What happens? This particular style of practice comes to my attention, which is just, look at omnipotent way of practicing. One insight did indeed settle it all. So if we ask, well, how does the Dharma Kings help? Well, they give us like the best practices possible. How could you have better help than that, actually? I mean, that's the ultimate gem, is to have a practice like this, isn't it? Would I trade this practice for all the jewelry in the world? And the answer, of course, not on your life would I do that. All the jewelry in the world is like garbage compared to this way of practicing. and the flesh wears all these jewelry. He says, this is where you get dazzled. This is where the dazzlement is. And the flesh, the misery, the blindness, the sickness, the death, and failure to settle anything. And this is where you're dazzled. Look at all this gorgeous jewelry I'm wearing, and I'm dazzling. But they don't have a clue how to practice, right? They don't have a clue. And so it's just garbage. It's absolute garbage. One insight did indeed settle it all. Wow. One insight did indeed settle it all. Wow. You see, as if it's already happened and it's already settled. And so, again, speculation is just laid to rest. R.I.P. Rest in peace, speculation. That is for sure. So don't worry what the insight is. What we're going for is dropping the speculation, getting used to not thinking or speculating. That's what we're going for. That's what's important. That's what the continuity fear is wrapped up around. The insight will come as soon as our continuity fear is set, you know, is evaporated. We'll easily be able to see it. It's obvious. It's actually totally obvious. I've glimpsed it before, but then the continuity fear comes up, right? We've all probably glimpsed it. The continuity fear comes in and says, yeah, but what happened to my thinking and thoughts? And I said, well, something weird happened. Well, that's speculation. All our speculation, you know, just dropped away. So we're practicing just being free of all speculation. One insight did indeed settle it all. That's it. Wow. Just wow. There's no speculation taking place. It's just wow. I don't have to think at all. I don't have to speculate at all. I don't have to speculate at all. One insight did indeed settle it all. Settled it all. So, yeah, there's a lot of positivity going around the world, and people are trying to share positivity, but here we have this super practice that, I mean, you rarely come across something like this. This is like a, you know, gem. This way, way more important to be able to practice like this. One insight did indeed settle it all. And say it as if you are actually the one in that position to say this. That you've experienced, you now are authoritatively saying, one insight did indeed settle it all. for me. You're talking for yourself. It did indeed settle it all. You don't say, you're not speaking for Longchenpa. Say, oh, for Longchenpa, one insight settled all. You're speaking for yourself. So in the first person self, speaking for yourself, one insight did indeed settle it all. Now, of course, this is going to give rise to the wow. It's almost a bit unnerving. I was like, wow, I didn't know we could even practice in this way. One insight did indeed settle it all. One insight did indeed settle it all. Okay, well, I'm not going to try and forge ahead. Well, who knows? Maybe I will. You never know. But so we think, hey, what am I missing? Speculation. How do I bring it back? Just tell ourselves one insight did indeed settle it all. Try that and see how it feels. I'm feeling it like, wow, sends ripples. Like, oh. Well, what about my despair? One insight did indeed settle it all. What about my trouble abiding? No, one insight did indeed settle it all. I mean, I'm enlightened? Yeah, one insight did indeed settle it all. Is it going to come back on me, my misery? No, one insight did indeed settle it all. It's like kind of a key to enlightenment. The opening, you know, if a door is locked, you got a key, you open it up. Oh, wow, this is it. One insight did indeed settle it all. Just remind yourself of that. This is what happened. One insight did indeed settle it all. It's funny, no matter how much weight you lose, you always still think you're fat. Right? It's like, what? Oh, I gotta lose more weight. I'm still, you know, chubby. Oh, the fat there. You know, it's like, you're not gonna be like when you were 16. You know, it's like skinny. You know, skinny, you know, right? Skinny. You can't really get that skinniness back very easily, can you? People try. Get their body fat down, yeah, but it doesn't seem to work very well. But I guess if you use, you know, drugs, you could do it, but you're damaging your system by doing that. Who knows, your kidneys may fail at some point. You don't want your kidneys to fail, believe me. That's why you don't want to do anything to damage your kidneys. Bad news. I don't want to go negative, but anyway, stay positive. Well, that insight solved that too. One insight did indeed settle it all. Emphasis on the all. So there's this vastness now. Total vastness with no speculation at all. Totally smoothed out. One insight did indeed settle it all. Keep in mind, Tibetan Buddhists are the extreme adepts in bringing you to enlightenment. They're extreme adepts, have extreme experience in this. I don't know who could say they have more experience. So we're certainly in good hands in this way. I am, at least. I believe they have an absolute clear recognition of just, you know, exactly how to finesse this whole situation, you know, to reach the goal. They just have studied it backwards and forwards so much from every which way and passed it on and kept, you know, studying and kept adding. Like, it's kind of like, you know, spiritual scientists. They are, you know, amazing spiritual scientists who really know the curriculum so well, such experts in it. You know, it's not some new age pop thing that we're just throwing something out there. No, they know it backwards and forwards and up this way and this way and this way and this way and every which way. One insight did indeed settle it all. This is a spiritual workout. I feel the trepidation. I feel the intensity. You know, and all these feelings as if I'm experiencing that. You know, experiencing having it all solved. It's all solved. One insight did indeed solve it all, as if this is what I'm experiencing now. As if. It's like lifting a barbell. You're doing curls or something. But you're really preparing to lift a wheelbarrow up or something, you know, where something awkward is. And so, You're lifting the barbells and you're imagining, I'm lifting this wheelbarrow, I'm lifting the wheelbarrow, you know, you keep your eye on the goal. So you are preparing to do the lift. Once I did indeed settle it all. So we're not quite experiencing the experience which is our goal, but we're you know, like right on the edge of it, so to speak. We're just, it's like a simulation of it, so to speak. We're just allowing ourselves to imagine, to believe, to have faith that we did indeed, since it's a done deal already, we can say we indeed, one inside did indeed settle it all. And we could say the Dharma kings, and the Dharma kings did indeed lead us to enlightenment. They absolutely did indeed lead us to enlightenment. So view the Dharma kings in that light, that they've already succeeded in leading us to enlightenment. And start getting used to that feeling, that we were helped, successfully helped. It's like Sherpas leading us to the top of Mount Everest. At some point we realize they did indeed lead us to the top of Mount Everest. But we know they're going to, so why not start using our creative imagination and say, yes, indeed they did. Absolutely no more questions arise at all. It's, one insight did indeed settle it all. No questions, no confusion, no doubts, none of that's arising at all. The Dharma kings did indeed give us the right practice that led to this, having one insight settling it all. They did indeed lead us to that. So look at them in that light, that they already, indeed, they succeeded. They did indeed lead us to the one insight that settled it all for us. Another perfect California night here. Ridiculous, the weather's so nice. It's just ridiculous. Wow, I was somewhere today in a beautiful spot and just looking out, and the breeze are coming up the hillside, and the sky and the trees and the, I just said, wow, it's just gorgeous. It's just like, I just kind of shook my head saying, you know, I don't know. But, you know, this still isn't it, right? The nice weather isn't it. So, homage to the Dharma kings, and with the feeling that they did indeed succeed. They have succeeded. So look at them in that light. You've already had one insight, did indeed settle it all for me. And so they were right. They were absolutely right. So look at them not as to petition them now, but that they've already succeeded. So have that feeling. What is that feeling? Just look at him that way. Look at it in that light. Just look at it. Don't even have to. Don't try to find a feeling. Just look at it in that light that they've already succeeded. The Dharma kings did indeed settle it all for you. They succeeded. Their way did indeed settle it all. Their way did indeed settle it all. And we have escaped, woken up from this mythical realm that we've just thought should exist. Now we see it never did exist. It never was here at all. We were just looking at our shoulds. And that's... Oh, it's pretty rough to send back into thinking and speculating and imagining all that after practicing. But we mustn't struggle. You said struggling not to. Then it really makes it worse. It makes it worse. So we just try to just kind of just stay wowish. Just wow. A smile on her face, sense of humor. Don't struggle. Don't struggle. Remain confident and stay engaged. Now, you know, what do I do? It's getting late, but probably go to sleep. I'll look at more like hammers of Nisargadatta Maharaj. Ram Maharshi. I'll look at, you know, Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma. I'll look at... the Dharma kings, Jesus, man, you know, do what I can do. So stay engaged with the Dharma kings is basically what I do. Now, we have a number of them now, so it's pretty easy to stay engaged. And just the fact that you know that there's this practice you can do gives you enormous confidence. Because when you do this practice, you know that that's exactly what these great spiritual teachers, these Dharma kings, advise you to do. So you're doing what they advise you to do. So you feel very confident and relaxed in their presence. Like, you're not like, you know, an idiot, screw it up. Like, I have no... No, you're doing what they advise you to do. And you know that they're smiling, saying, wow, it's great. You know, you're going to... You're one insight already did settle it all for me. Wow. So it gives you this enormous confidence and leverage over the world. Fourth of July is over, buddy. Shut it off, shut it off, buddy. Now I shut you down. It happened on the strip where the road is wide. Two cool shorts standing side by side. My fuel ejected Stingray and a 413. We're revving up our engines and it sounds real mean. Tack it up, buddy. Now I shut you down. Tack it up, buddy. Gonna shut you down. Declining numbers at an even rate. At the count of one, we both accelerate. My Stingray is light, the slicks are starting to spin, but the 413's really digging in. Gotta be cool now, power shift, here we go. Super stock dart winding out in low, but my fuel injector Stingray's really starting to go. To get the traction, I'm riding the clutch. The pressure plate's burning, that machine's too much. Da 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 da. Pedals to the metal, here is the dual quads drink. Now the 413's lead is starting to shrink. He's hot with ram induction, but it's understood. I got a fuel injection engine sitting under my hood. Shut it down, shut it down, shut it down. Shut it off, buddy, I shut you down. Shut it off, buddy, now I shut you down. Shut it off, buddy, now I shut you down. Goes like that. Shut off the speculation, buddy. I shut you down. You know, it's ego. You're shut down. It's one insight. Settle it all. What was that? I guess it was my fuel injected engine sitting under my hood. So somebody's out there. Time to shut it down, buddy. Yeah. Shut it off. I'm not in a singing mood. That is for sure. It's funny, when you're in a singing mood, you can sing. When you're not, I don't feel like it. I can generate it, you know, if I had to, but it'd be forcing the issue right now. I'm in too much of a wowish mood to sing. Don't feel so musical at the moment. I may practice my voice now, singing though, now in the next several days, because at least tomorrow, because my body's so tired, I think I have to give it a rest from working out. But singing works out the diaphragm. We've got to work out the diaphragm and the vocal cords and all that. Might as well. So, cooling down here. Cooling down. Back to the blahs, you know, going back to the blahs. Okay, we're going back to the blahs. But we have this practice. The Dharma Kings have our back. We're in great shape right now. We may feel tired. I feel tired, but I'm in great shape right now. This is how I'm looking at it and think, wow. And so I'll just carry this feeling like I'm in just superlative shape right now. One insight has already settled it all. Wow. And keep in mind, we're all contemporaneous here. We're all here in this world right now. That means we're contemporaries, okay? So we have to have love for one another here because we're contemporary. We're in the world right now, all of us. We should look at it that way. We shouldn't look at it and say, well, there's the young people or there's the old people or that sort of stuff. No, we're all contemporaries right now. We're all experiencing the world right now, the way it is, right? Doesn't matter how old someone is, or you experienced the 60s back then. Well, I'm experiencing the world as it is right now, just as you are. This is every, right? So we're contemporary. So any success of our contemporaries is something we just gotta like, yeah, you know, we gotta cheer for one another. Absolutely gotta cheer for one another right now. We're all contemporaries here right now. Forget about age. sort of lack confidence because we think, well, all these contemporaries, and we're just, are we getting it? Are we getting it? Wow. One insight did indeed settle it all. So cheer for one another, cheer for one another, cheer for one another. It's not just, when did I graduate from high school? It's I'm quote unquote in the world, in this blah land, but we're getting it. We're getting it. The Dharma kings are back. They're back for everybody. So we're living in a time. We're all contemporaneous of a time when the Dharma kings return in a powerful way here in the world. So this is super awesome to be a contemporary of one another here right in this world. Super awesome. And I dare say I could probably beat pretty much anybody running up a hill right now. So, don't go ageist on me, right? Let's not go ageist yet. Not right now. Someone wants to race up a hill. Okay, let's race up the stairs. Let's see who gets there first. Although not tomorrow. Yeah, wow. I did run up a driveway. I ran up something today. Pump, 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 pump. It's like nothing. It's like nothing to me now. Running uphill, it's like nothing. Hardly even got winded at all. Just like, that's easy. Before, are you kidding me? It was like the biggest challenge in the world. Can I run up this driveway, this steep driveway? Can I run up? Well, I don't know. What's going to happen to me if I run up it? Now, it's like, what the heck? Instead of walking up, I said, why don't I just run up for fun? I just did it for fun. I'll just do it for fun. Boom, 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 boom. Nothing. It's like nothing. I did indeed settle it. Okay, very great. All right, back to blah 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 land. Blah 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 blah. I'm gone underwater again. The blah land. But just stay in your heart. Just cheer yourself on. Cheer everybody else on. Cheer everyone on here. Cheer everyone on as much as we can. I know that's easier said than done, but let's do it anyway. Okay. Very great. That's it for this one.